Hello students, today we will discuss about the various secondary memory related issues and how they are being organized. So we will first discuss about the basic hard disk organization. So as you know, hard disk is the memory that is used as the secondary memory of a computer system. So as we all know that we require more memory spaces for the permanent storage of data that is to be maintained for longer time, and there we cannot utilize the basic cache memory or the primary memory, which are volatile, and we need to store the data permanently within a permanent storage device. So the main memory a device that is used with any computer system is actually called as a hard disk. So how this hard disk is being organized within the computer system, that we will discuss in detail in this session. So as you know, the hard disk is a unit that is a sealed unit, contains a number of platters. So we need to remember some of the terms that are associated with hard disk. So I am having a pictorial representation of the hard disk organization, and based on that I will give some description on the organization of hard disk. So a hard disk is a sealed unit, contains a number of platters in a stack. So what is this platters? Platters means it is like a CD shaped thing. So it will be having a number of platters. A number of platters, they are stored in a stack one after another. We'll be having a number of platters. They are placed in an order. Okay, so if you look at the exact representation, so in this diagram you can see this is the platter. So this is the platter, one platter. This is another platter. This is another platter. So we are having a number of platters. That is this rounded shape platters, they are placed one after another, and which form the platters, which is the basic element of a particular hard disk device. Then they are actually mounted in a horizontal or a vertical position. So some of the hard disk platters are placed in this pattern as I have given in the diagram. Similarly, some of the hard disk, they are placing the platters in horizontal format also. So this is vertical format and this is horizontal format. So it depends on the hard disk shape that is being designed. Sometimes we can place all the platters in vertical format, or we can place all the platters in horizontal format also. Similarly, we will be having a read write head, because if you want to read a particular portion of a platter, we need to place a head over that particular platter. So with each platter we will be having a read write head associated. So we will be having a read write head, or number of read write heads are positioned above and below each platter. So the specialty of this platter is we can read the data from top as well as we can read the data from bottom also. So both from both sides we can read or write. So the read write heads will be pointing towards the top and bottom of each platter. So every platter will be having, so look at this diagram. So this platter, we are having a read write head on top and a read write head on bottom. Similarly, for this platter we are having two read write heads. For this platter also we are having two read write head available, that is with all the platters. Now the platters are actually spinning, so they'll be rotating. So when we start reading from a particular hard disk, what is happening is that disk will be, all the platters will be spinning, and the drive heads will be moving on the surface of these plate is. So it will be moving towards the center and towards the outer edge of the platter. So when the platter is spin, that is the procedure to be followed. When the platter is spin, this read write head will be moving this from inner area to outer area and from outer area to inner area according to the rotation. So that will be the happening of, so we need to read the data from all this entire surface. So now to reach all this location, the platter will be rotating and the read write head will be moving towards the inner portion as well as towards the outer portion of the platter. Similarly, the drive heads can reach the entire surface of each platter, so that we can reach all the locations of a platter present in the hard disk. Now, where this data will be stored in a hard disk? So in each hard disk, the data is stored in a thin concentric bands. So we'll be having several locations. So we'll be having several sub locations. So one of the example is given here, one band, that is this circle. So data is stored in several divisions like this one, several thin bands. So we'll be having a number of similar thin bands available, and which is usually called as a track. So this ring, so a drive head while in one position can read or write a circular ring or band. So this band, this concentric band, is actually called as a track. So a platter will be divided into a number of track, and there can be, one example is given like one, there can be more than 1000 of tracks on a normal 3.5 inch hard disk. So it will be having more than 1000 number of tracks available with the hard disk that is present in a computer system. So we'll be having, each platter will be having a number of tracks. Similarly, all the tracks will be having a number of, all the platters will be having a number of tracks, and within these track, how we are going to store the data. Okay, so this is the representation of the hard disk. So we'll be having an arm assembly where we are placing all the read write heads, and which is connected or which will be on the surface of different platters, and each platter will be having some tracks available. So track is given here. So this is the track, this is one track, this is another track, this is another track. Okay, so now what are the other things that are happening with this system? Now the sections with each track are called sectors. So now each track is again divided into sectors. Each track is again divided into sectors. So you can see this is one sector, this is one sector, this is one sector. Similarly, each track is again divided into a number of sectors. So why we are dividing these? First of all, we are dividing the platter into a number of tracks, and each track is divided into a number of sectors because each sector is used for placing each data with some limited capacity. So this is the way how we are storing the data into a hard disk device. So the hard disk may be mounted in a horizontal or vertical position. I have already mentioned, sometimes if the hard disk means platters are in horizontal order, so the it will be placed in horizontal position, or if it is in vertical mode, it will be placed in vertical position. Now the read write heads are positioned above and below each platter. I have already mentioned that as the platter spin, so when the platter spin, so this is already being discussed, right? So we will see the further description of this. So a sector is the smallest physical storage unit. So a track is divided into a number of sectors, and this sector is the individual smallest unit of the storage unit, and it is usually of 512 bytes or 0.5 KB in size. So each sector will be having a capacity of 0.5 KB. Now the structure of the hard drives will refer to a cylinder header section notation. So it is represented, the structure is represented like a cylinder head sector notation. So why it is called as cylinder head section sector notation? So by looking at the diagram, we can see that a cylinder is formed on this position between each of this track. It is forming like a cylinder. So this is one example. This is the inner track. If all the tracks are in same position, we are forming a cylinder. So we'll be having a cylinder. Then we'll be having the head. So with each cylinder, we'll be having the head position somewhere, which is exactly at the same location now. And within each sector, we'll be having the head of the drive. So with each cylinder, the head position will be on a particular sector. So it is forming a cylinder. So cylinder is formed while all drive heads are in the same position on the disk. If all are at the same position, it is forming like a cylinder shape. Now the tracks stacked on top of each other form a cylinder. So different tracks stacked on top of each other. So each track means each track will be above each, that means at the same line it is forming a cylinder. So this is the concept that is followed in a hard disk drive. Now the tracks are numbered from 0 to 1023. So every track will be having a number. So the outermost edge of the disk, that track will be called as 0, and the highest number, that is the center portion of the drive, that is the center track, is having a number called as 1023. So if one entire platter consists of 1023 tracks starting from 0 to 1023. So similarly, there are 1024 cylinders. So automatically we'll be having 1024 cylinders, 0 to 1023 cylinders will be formed on a hard disk device. And how the data are stored in the track? So the data bits are stored serially on a track. So if this is the track where if you want to place some data, the data will be stored serially one after another. Data will be stored serially or consecutively one after another. And the data are preceded by a sector header that contains an identification, address or information. So each sector, so within the track, if this is a sector, each sector will be having a beginning portion that is called as an identification address, in order to identify the address of this particular sector. Assume that if you are having a sector here, the beginning of this will be having an identification address in order to identify this particular address for getting a particular data. Now following the data, after storing all the data, following the data, we are having some additional bits that are used for the error correcting code. So if you are having some error correction to be done on the data present in the track, we'll be having an additional bits that are associated with each sector. So each sector will be having an identification address on beginning, and at the end we'll be having some additional bits that are used for the error correction purpose, which is usually called as ECC code, error correction code. Now they are used to detect and correct errors that are occurring during the writing and reading of the that sector capacity data, that is 512 data bytes. Again, between two tracks will be having a small gap available. Between two tracks there will be a small gap in order to distinguish between these two, differentiate between these two. So that is called as an intersector gap. If there is a gap between two sets, so normally between each tracks there will be a small gap being maintained to differentiate two different sectors, which is usually called as intersector gap. Now the next point is there are two techniques, that means two way we are keeping a disk. One is in unformatted and second one is in formatted form. So unformatted disk are those disks which is not having any information on its tracks, that is called as unformatted. So normally we can utilize a disk that is already being formatted, otherwise we cannot store the data in tracks and sectors. So when we are doing formatting, that time only the entire disk is divided into number of tracks and sectors. Now formatting divides the disk physically into tracks and sectors. So formatting procedure is always a must, because when we buy a computer system and when we are placing a hard disk, usually they are doing formatting. They are doing formatting means they are dividing that disk into a number of tracks and sectors. So this process will discover some defective sectors. So sometimes there will be some sectors that are defective, some issue, some sectors we cannot properly utilize. So that will be discovered during the formatting process. Now the disk controller, the entire hard disk controller, will keep a record of such defects which are available within the hard disk, and they will exclude those positions from the use of any program. So there will be some portions which cannot be utilized properly, so that will be identified during formatting, and which will be that will be kept in a particular record. Now the capacity of a formatted disk, so formatted disk is the disk which can be utilized for reading and writing. So the capacity of a formatted disk is proper indicator of the storage capability of the given disk. So the formatted disk capacity will be deciding the storage capability of a particular disk. And the formatting information also accounts for about 15% of the total information that can be stored on a disk. It will have some additional information, about 15% of total information that can be stored on a disk. So it will be having some additional information that, so if 100 MB is the capacity of the disk, no, the entire 100 MB cannot be utilized for storing data. So some percentage will be reserved for information, some other information related to the memory. Now it consists of, as I have already mentioned, it consists of sector headers, additional error correction bits, and there will be an intersector gap between different sectors. Now in a typical computer, the disk is subsequently divided into logical partitions. So it will be divided into number of partitions. Normally we are doing partitions like what we are doing, for example, C drive, D drive, E drive, etc. are actually the division of the hard disk into separate partitions, so that we can distribute the data into different locations and we can easily access them according to our requirement. So that is why we are doing, along with formatting, we are doing the partitions also. So and normally we are not utilizing the entire disk area together. We are giving some partition. So partition will be having some additional advantages also, now that we are not discussing now. Now each track has same number of sectors. Now listen to the next point. Every track will be having the same number of sectors only. Every track, even if it is an outer track or an inner track, the number of division remains the same. So this is the inner track and this is the outer track. So as you know, here how many numbers of sectors are there, the same numbers will be there in the outer track also. But there will be the there will be more gap between different sectors present in the outer sectors. So all tracks have the same storage capacity also. So whatever capacity is possible with this inner track, the same will be there in the outer track sectors also. So what is the difference between these two? So the information is packed more densely on inner tracks. So inner tracks, we are having very small area, so there the information is packed more densely. So density is more for the inner tracks than the outer tracks. Outer tracks we are having more space available, but inner track both consist of the same capacity, but here it is stored more densely. Now some arrangements are used in many disks because it simplifies the electronic circuits needed to access the data. You know, to access data on different density of data with the same capability, some arrangements are used for accessing, because here we need to pass through more area. Here it is required to pass through only less number of areas. So some arrangements are made for accessing these data depending on the size of the sectors. So it is also not possible to increase the storage density by placing more sectors on outer tag. So it is not possible to place more sectors on outer tag. That will never be allowed, even if we are having more space available. So we are maintaining uniformity among all the tracks present in the hard disk. Even if it is having longer circumference on the outer track, it is not having more number of sectors being created on the outer tracks. So this scheme, the scheme that was discussed now, was actually followed on most of the larger disk available in the market. Now we will discuss about disk arrays. Disk arrays. So what is a disk array? Disk array is a hardware element that contains a large group of hard disk drives. So initially we were discussing about a single hard disk. Now we are thinking about a group of hard disk drives. We'll be having a group of, so this is one hard disk drive, this is another hard disk, this is another hard disk. So many situations, if you want to have more storage to be done, we need to use more number of hard disk drives. So the array of number of hard disks form a disk array. So it may contain several disk drive trays. So so each will be placed on different trays. So each hard disk drive will be placed on different trays and has an architecture which improves speed and increases data protection. So for each drive, it should have its own architecture that we were discussing in the previous slides. Everything must be maintained on each of these individual hard disk drive. So it is used for block based and file based or object storage. So block based storage means if you want to store different blocks of data separately, and if you want to store different files separately, and if you want to store different objects separately, in these situations we are using this hard disk array. So different arrays can be, different hard disk can be reserved for different types of data that can be stored. Now this disk arrays, normally the placement of different number of hard disk drives as an array, this disk arrays can be generally categorized into two. One is called as network attached storage arrays, and second one is called as storage area network arrays. So we'll see it in detail. So network attached storage, that is NAS arrays, network attached storage, as the name indicates, it is a storage or set of hard disk arrays. They are attached to the network. Just like a network will be having a number of devices connected into the same network, the disk array is also attached. That is actually called as network attached storage arrays. Now the second category is called as storage area network arrays. Storage area network array, the difference is it is also connected to the network, but it is associated with a particular server. Into that server, we are having a small network where we'll be having some array of disks that are being stored, that is having access to only the server. It is not connected to the, so we'll be having a separate network associated with the server. No other client of this network can access this particular disk array. That is storage area network arrays. It is a special network where the server can access the storage hard disk drives. So as you know, this storage area network can again be divided into modular storage area network arrays, monolithic storage area network arrays, utility storage arrays. So three categories of storage area network arrays are available. So we are not going to see in detail about these categories. So the server side, it is further divided into a larger network where we will be having a number of disk arrays are placed. Now similarly, the hard disk we got another point related to the hard disk array, that is called as storage virtualization, that we will see soon. So we were discussing about disk arrays, why we require disk arrays, what are the categories of disk arrays, and some additional property that is related to disk array, that is called as storage virtualization, that we will be seeing soon. Now there will be a system. The system is actually, that means the disk array system is actually run through a storage controller. So we'll be having a general controller controls the working of the entire disk array, and which will be coordinating the activity of the entire unit. So disk array is the backbone of modern storage networking environments, because nowadays we require more data to be accessed through online, because which is connected to the network. If you are having some concept like a movie on demand, or if you are accessing some YouTube or similar bulk storage device communication, so that situation several access to be done, because most of the clients or more number of clients are trying to access more data simultaneously. So we require more storage that are distributed among the network. So from different network devices, we need to access different types of data simultaneously. So disk arrays plays an important role for the storage of data and the access of those data when different clients are connected to the network. Then we are having a concept called as logical units. So it is associated with the disk array. So the data within a disk array is organized into logical units. So disk array consists of a number of hard disk drives placed separately on different trays together, and they are organized into logical units. So the disk array contents are organized into different logical units, and which is actually connected through SCSI interface. That means small computer system interface, SCSI interface, which is through which only we are actually communicating with the logical units that are part of the disk array. So the IO input or output, the data requirement commands are sent to the storage target and executed by the logical unit within that target. So for accessing different types of data present in the disk array, the input request will be arriving through the SCSI interface, and it is connected to the logical unit, and the logical unit will be retrieving the data that is being requested by the user by using the logical unit. Now there is a logical unit number, LUN, which is a unique identifier that is used to distinguish between devices that share the same SCSI bus. So into the same SCSI bus, if this is the bus, will be having some number of units are connected. Some number of units are connected to the same SCSI bus, which is the interface between the clients and the disk array. So we are providing a logical unit number. So we will be using several SCSI interfaces. With each SCSI number, each one will be given a separate unique number for identifying the different units connected to the same SCSI interface. Now the commands are sent to the SCSI controller, identify the devices based on their logical unit numbers. So SCSI controller will identify the corresponding disk array logical units by referring to the logical unit number. Now we will see about network attached storage. Network attached storage. So as I have mentioned, this is the network, means the storage is attached to an entire network. So it is a file level computer storage data, mean computer data storage server that is connected to the computer network, providing data access to different groups of clients. Heterogeneous groups of clients means the clients with different requirements. Different types of systems, different types of operating systems that are connected to the network, and the network attached storage will deliver the required data for that particular different category of users. Now it is specialized for serving files by its hardware, software or configuration. So network attached storage is specialized for serving or accessing files by its hardware, software or configuration. Now it is often manufactured as a computer appliance, that is it is often used for a specialized requirement, that means a purpose built specialized computer. So if a computer is particularly used for accessing some particular type of data, means a particular computer appliance, just like a home appliance for a computer appliance, for some particular type of data to be accessed, we can utilize this network attached storage device arrays, disk arrays. Now this is the NAS systems are networked appliances which contain one or more storage drives. So more number of drives will be available automatically because it is a means array of drives, and they are arranged into logical and redundant storage containers, that means in the form of a RAID. RAID actually indicates the group of drives together that is connected together to have a huge amount of storage capability. So redundant, sometimes the disk, the data will be repeated, that is why it is called as redundant storage containers. So some data for backup we need to maintain more number of times. So in order to support those things, we are using a concept called as RAID. So we'll see in detail about RAID in some of the other sessions, and which is part of, so RAID are actually part of a larger network that is trying to access some particular type of data through the network for a particular computer appliance that is specified for a particular task or particular purpose. And it also removes the responsibility of file serving from other servers on the network. So the responsibility of file serving for a particular network is actually controlled by that network attached storage device alone, and for particular some other particular type of data which will be having some other storage device available through which it will be having the access to that system which is specified for some other purpose. Now, a full-featured operating system is not needed on a network attached system. So it is often stripped down, that means a stripped down, because for the access to the storage and network attached storage device, it does not require a complete operating system. It requires some that system that is capable of following the memory related operations. It is not requiring an operating system which is like which is required for a very complete computer system. It normally provides access to files. So generally for file related operations only we require the usage of this particular operating system, and it requires some file sharing protocols like NFS, SMB or AFP protocols, which are usually used with file related communication. Now the benefits that are compared to the general purpose service are for with this network attached service system, storage system, that is the serving the specialties are, it is serving files which includes faster data access, and which is providing an easier administration, and the configuration is also very simple in the case of the network attached storage device. So this is one category of disk array, network attached storage device. Now this is the structure I have already mentioned. So this is a network, a simple network, where we are having a switch through which all other systems are being connected. So this is one client, this is client 2, this is client 3, and this is server 1, this is server 2, and into the same network a network attached storage NAS is being connected. Here you can see a number of drives, that is disk array, a number of disk are being connected. So we are forming a disk array here. All together it is placed separately on a separate system. That is why we require a separate operating system for managing this particular network attached storage device, only for the operations related to this storage device. For this system we require a complete OS, for this also we require a complete OS, for other even servers also we require a complete operating system, but for this particular network attached storage device it requires only an OS which is supporting only the working of file access related to the disk arrays. So this is a system that is used for only storage purpose and for accessing the data associated with the disk array, which will be controlled by a storage controller. Okay, so in a larger network some clients are connected, servers are connected, and all these are connected to a network attached storage device. So if a client want to access some data from server, it can access from server. If the client requires some data which is there in the disk array, which can be accessed from the disk array, any client can access it from the disk array. The server can also access this thing from the disk array. So sometimes the request is sent to the server and the server will be accessing the content from the disk array. Okay, so into a larger network a number of clients are attached, number of servers are attached, and some network attached storage devices are also attached, and they are controlled by a network unit like switch. Now the next category of disk array is called as storage area network, SAN, second category of disk array. Now it's a network which provides access to consolidated or block level data storage. It is a special network, storage area network, which is used for providing access to consolidated block level data storage. So the architecture is slightly different when we compare with the NAS system. Now SAN is primarily used to enhance storage devices such as disk arrays, tape libraries, optical jukeboxes, which are accessible to servers, so that the devices appear to the OS is as locally attached devices. So in the NAS concept we are having a separate system for storing all these disk arrays, but this is actually connected to some system like a server, which is connected to the server, and these devices or the disk array will be controlled by the server associated with that particular device. Now it will be having its own network, so different storage devices are coming under a single network and they are attached to the server, so they are generally not accessible through the local area network. So in the previous case, network attached storage device, any client can directly access to the disk array, but in this case directly a client cannot have an access to the storage device or the disk array. So it should be done with the support of a server. So closely these devices are connected to the servers, and if a client wishes to access some data, client need to have a request to the server, and server will be communicating with this network of storage devices, and it will access the data and which will be communicated back to the client. But the cost and complexity of SAN, they are actually being dropped in early 2000 to levels allowing wider adoption across both enterprise and small to medium sized business. So which is a very commonly used mechanism, the cost also being reduced recently after 2000. So storage area network is a better option for accessing the data which are stored in a very huge manner with the support of disk arrays. The SAN storage area network does not provide file abstraction. It is only using a block level operations. Some block level data capturing only is permitted with the storage area network. As in the NAS, it is actually accessing file and file access and their file together. But in the case of SAN, block by block access only being permitted. However, file system built on top of storage area network do provide file access. So so the SAN will be further having a file system which is also connected to the SAN, which can provide file level access, and that concept is usually called as shared disk file system. So individually it is not permitting any file access, but a file system is associated with an SAN through which it can have access to the file system. So this is the pictorial representation of a storage area network. So this is one client, another client, another client, another client. This is the wide area network. There is a switch between these clients, another switch for this client. Here you can see one server, here you can see another server, here you can see another server. And with these servers, we are having a disk array system here, a tape library here, an optical jukebox here. So this is SAN. That means to the servers we are having with a single server or some multiple servers, this large storage disk arrays are being connected. Now if a client wishes to access some data from any of these disk array, it will be giving request to. So if it is requiring some mail, it will be giving a request to the mail server, and mail server will refer through any of these disk arrays with the support of SAN. Now if a client is giving a request for an application, it will be communicated through the application server, through which it will be connected to the disk arrays. And similarly, if it is in requirement of a database, it will be connected, the client will be communicated with the server, database server, and the server will be searching and finding the data from any of these disk array. So the thing is, the client cannot have a direct communication with this storage area network. In the case of network attached storage, the client can directly access that disk array, but here with the support of corresponding server only. So along with these servers and different disk arrays, it is forming a network. That is why it is called as storage area network. So the difference between network attached storage and storage area network is very, very important. Both are used for storage of huge data in the form of disk arrays, but the access to the clients and the other attributes are different for NAS as well as SAN concept. Now storage virtualization, I have mentioned about one additional property of the disk array is storage virtualization. So storage virtualization is the process of presenting a logical view of the physical storage. So storage virtualization is a process of providing a logical view. Just like what you say about virtual memory. Virtual memory is the concept that is used for providing that virtualization of primary memory. So similarly, here also for the storage secondary virtualization, we are using the concept of storage virtualization, which provides the logical view of the physical storage resources of a computer system. By treating all storage media like hard disk, optical disk, tape, etc. As a single pool of storage. So we are having different hard disk, optical disk, tape, etc. All the devices are available, different devices are available, but from the client side, they will be accessing the data from any of these locations without knowing its internal details. So that is why it is given the name virtualization. Now storage system typically use special hardware and software with the disk drives to provide very fast and reliable storage for computing and data processing. And storage systems are also complex, and they require special purpose computer to provide storage capacity. Means whichever system that is used for only storage purpose, which will be having a special configuration. It should have advanced data protection features, and disk drives are only one element within a storage system. So the main element required is the disk drive to manage those disk, along with the hardware and the special software that are required for communicating with the internal storage. And the storage system can provide either block access data or file access data. Both can be possible with the storage system. And the block access is typically delivered over fiber channels. So for block access data, we are using some channels like fiber, SESI, SAS, FICON, etc. And some other protocols are also being used. And for file access, we are using some protocols like NFS or SMB protocols. So storage virtualization is the process of presenting only the logical view of the real storage that are available within the computer system. Within the context of a storage system, there are two types of virtualization. So based on, as I have already mentioned, both for block access data and file access, we are using this disk arrays. So virtualization can also be divided into two categories. One is block virtualization and second one is file virtualization. So what is this block virtualization? It is used with the context that refers to the abstraction of logical storage from physical storage, so that it may be accessed without regard to physical storage or heterogeneous structure. So block virtualization, regardless of the internal structure, how it is being stored and what structure and what mechanism it is being forwarded, it is having an access to that particular memory area. That means it is being abstracted from the user about how many partitions are available within the storage, how many storage devices are available. Without knowing all this, we can access the data. Without knowing the number of blocks available, etc., you can have access to the internal memory storage. And the separation allows the administrators of the storage system greater flexibility to manage storage for the end users. So end user never bother about the internal structure of the memory. It can just give a request and it is getting the data without knowing any. That is why it is called as virtualization. Now the second category is file virtualization, which addresses network attached storage device challenges by eliminating dependencies between the data accessed at the file level. So file virtualization is actually related with the file access. File access is usually done with network attached storage devices, and the challenges of this NAS will be managed by using the file virtualization concept. That is, the dependencies between the data access at the file level and the location where the files are physically stored. So the user is given a request to the file and the user doesn't know where the file is actually being stored, which location it is being stored. So without knowing all this, the network controller will have the access to the file which is stored in any of the location. So it provides the opportunity to optimize the storage use and also different server consolidation and to perform non-disruptive files migration. So different file can be migrated from or moved from one location to another location. We don't need to bother about all this. Without having all this information, the user can have access to the files which are stored in any of the location. So block virtualization as well as file virtualization, working in the same manner, without knowing, without having any internal information, without having any problem related to the internal data change or location change or block change or size of the data or the file location change, we can have the access to the entire data according to the request given by the client. That is all about the disk array basic concepts. We were discussing about the basic hard disk organization. We have seen the structure of the hard disk, how it is placed, how the data can be accessible, what are the different components associated with the basic hard disk. Then we have seen the disk arrays, what is disk array and how this disk array or what are the different uses of disk arrays and the types of disk arrays and the difference between those types of disk arrays. And also we have seen the concept called as virtualization, that is storage virtualization, which is associated with these secondary disk arrays storages. So we will see some more details related to this storage virtualization, that is how these elements are virtualized, or how it is actually being placed within these disk arrays. That is the basic concept like RAID strategy and all. We will see in some other video lecture. So that's it for now. Thank you.